got Matt Zimmerman with us, analyst, broadcaster, coach, great guy, host of the Razorback Daily along with Quinn Grovey. And I've been thinking about the experience that you're having in Indianapolis here, Matt. And it's different. I've had a little bit of the same experience with the college baseball team in Omaha in 2018. You know, we were there for 16 days.
Yeah.
You know, obviously it wasn't during a pandemic, but, you know, you how long have you been on the road now? Because this whole thing for you, didn't it started in Nashville, and you guys are still on the road.
Yeah, we were in Nashville, you know, left there. We were there a Thursday and came back on a Sunday. We decided to go ahead and come back to Arkansas. Chuck Barrett and I debated just driving straight north. It was only 4 hours. But we had a feeling, both of us, that there was going to be this run. And so, well, let's go back to Arkansas. So we went back to Arkansas. We got beat out on Saturday there by LSU. So we went home on Sunday. So we were home for 3 days. And that was nice to kind of recharge, get organized, get packed up. And then we left last Wednesday afternoon from Fayetteville. And came up here. So we're on day, you know, about day nine of the trip, and it's going to be hopefully 21 days and 20 nights. And so I packed for that, and that's what we're planning on being. And we've had a lot of, you know, we saw all the Razorback fans all weekend. There was all these Razorback folks here, and that was nice. And then you wake up Monday morning, and they're all gone. And so the Razorbacks are still here, but they're in quarantine, the hotel beside us at the Marriott. And so... You know, me and Chuck kind of on our own, and I haven't seen a Razorback fan since Monday morning when they were leaving. So they'll be back tomorrow, so it'll be nice. And, you know, normally, Phil, you know, we fly home after first and second round, or, you know, you always get that 3 or 4 day break, and you fly home, and we don't get that College World Series experience like you're talking about. We were gone for 16 or 20 days or something. So, but with the virus, and they told us, you know, to stay here. So that's what we're doing, and it's nice to be here.
Yeah, that does make the experience different for everybody, of course, because, I mean, if a team is going to the Sweet 16, they do come back home first, and they practice in their building, and they get the niceties of home, and sometimes they get pep rallies with fans, you know, even before the Final Four get to do that. These guys continue to be on lockdown. I know that the NCAA is trying to find things for them to do and everything, but it's a total 180 from what it used to be.
Yeah, you're exactly right, you know, I can remember whether it was Arkansas or Missouri or UAB. You know, you get that berth in the Sweet 16. Yeah, you get to fly home, and you know, people are there to greet you, and everyone's excited. And you know, or in 1990 when we were going to the Final Four. Now, I remember, we were in Dallas. We flew home, and there was thousands of people at Drake Field. We're getting ready to go to the Final Four. We got to come home for 3 days, and you get all that love and all that, and just so much attention. And they're still getting that. They're just not getting it in person. They're having to see it on social media. Of course, back in those days, you didn't have social media. So I'm sure they're feeling a lot of good attention and all that. But it would be nice if they could come home and enjoy that with their fans before you come back and try to win two more.
Well, and now it's time to really just, like, focus on the game, you know, coming up on Saturday. It's not like they weren't focusing on it, but, you know, they could go, I know Must said they played wiffle ball at the baseball park, they went to the zoo and all of that. All that stuff is done now. So now it's full game prep, get yourself ready for this opponent. I know they're not going to take Oral Roberts lightly because they know how good they are. Is it as simple as stopping O'Banner and Abmas? Can you do anything like that? I mean, they held Abmas to 11 points the first time out.
No.
He's a much different – he's a better scorer than he was then. How does Arkansas win this game?
Well, I think that's just it. To me, they've got, you know, two players that probably out of all their guys that could come to Arkansas and fight for playing time and be good players here. And, you know, to me, their third best player, R.J. Glasper, a kid that walked on at Arkansas, he was – to me, their second best player in the game in Fayetteville. Max did not play well. The Razorbacks' size, their length, really, really, really bothered Max. He did not play good there. And R.J. Glasper had 14 points. And he's an Arkansas kid from Four City. He had a lot to prove. And then, unfortunately for R.J., a great kid, he blows out his knee, and he's done for the year. And so, you know, he hadn't gotten to play during this run for them. And they've done a really good job of regrouping without probably their third best player overall. But again, he was probably their best player that day in Bud Walton. But O'Banner's good. He's a tough, strong kid. He competes. We did not have Jalen Williams in that first game. And I think that Jalen Williams will get introduced to O'Banner right off the bat. And O'Banner probably will not like that introduction because Jalen's a really good defensive player. And it's not going to be near as easy for O'Banner to get those rebounds like he did in Bud Walton with Jalen Williams. Because now that the game he didn't play, coach at that time was still figuring out his rotation, his lineup. I mean, Debo plays 9 minutes, has 1 point. You know, obviously now him and Jalen are huge, crucial pieces, starters, and big pieces to the puzzle. I think ORU is probably a little better since then, but they took a blow because of losing R.J. Glasper. And the Razorbacks have gotten a whole lot better. And I think it's going to be a fun game for the Razorback Nation on Saturday.
Coach Matt Zimmerman joining us here on Halftime. Coach, you kind of led into the point that I was fixing to make with Devo only playing 9 minutes of action, the last ORU matchup, 1 rebound, 3 fouls, and Jalen not even seeing the floor in that ball game.
Yeah.
Out of those two, well, I'll phrase it this way. Who do you think will make the bigger difference Saturday? Is it going to be Devo Davis just with incredible tenacity on the defensive end of the floor, or do you think it's Jalen Williams guarding up the bigs as you just alluded to?
Well, gosh, I mean, that's a toss-up because they're both so good and they make such a big impact. I'll have to go with Jalen because I think you'll see the impact he has directly on Kevin O'Banner, and I think O'Banner will not be near as effective going against Jalen. And that's not a slight against O'Banner. I just think Jalen's he's really good, and I think that he will be able to outplay O'Banner inside the paint along with Justin Smith, you know, and whoever else gets in there to play inside, maybe even an Ethan. And don't wouldn't be surprised if he throws Connor out there some, you know, because it may be a game where he can play more guys. Obviously, the last game, Coach felt like, I'm going to play about six. I'm going to keep tight reins on it. But maybe he'll be able to loosen it up a little bit. I would say Jalen out of those two. Devo obviously is going to have a lot better game than 9 minutes and 1 point like he did in Bud Walton against ORU in December. But I would say, to answer your question directly, I'd have to say Jalen because he didn't play at all. He'll be very motivated. We interviewed him the other day, and he's like, yep, this is the game I didn't play, and I want to show him I can play, and I want this. And he's a pretty motivated guy. And, I mean, how nice was he? How good was he against Texas Tech? Mm-hmm. I mean, that was a thing of beauty, what he did. The passing, the rebounding, the defense, the charges. My gosh. And I think that ORU is not going to like their introduction to Jalen. They're not going to like that at all.
It's going to be a lot of fun to think this going forward. Yeah. And you talked earlier about like this team being solely focused on ORU, as they should be. But us as media,
they better be,
absolutely. But us as media, we can look ahead and kind of maybe jump around and kind of see what we think. Coach, for all intents and purposes, I feel like Baylor will move on to the Elite Eight and beat Villanova. So let's just assume for this question, you get Baylor versus Arkansas in the Elite Eight for the trip on the Final Four on the line. You've got Justin Smith playing incredibly well right now, and a team all together for the Razorbacks that's playing incredible. But Coach, Baylor is a darn good team this year. If it gets to that point, if it is Baylor versus Arkansas, because obviously we won't talk to you until then, what do you like? Is Baylor, obviously Baylor's the team to beat? What kind of chances do you have Arkansas to maybe try to advance against Baylor and maybe get to a Final Four?
Well, the Razorbacks can definitely beat Baylor. Baylor has been beat this year. There's been a couple of their losses. They really struggled shooting the basketball. You know, they are a good basketball team. They would be the best team that we will have played in the NCAA tournament, and arguably the best team we have played all season. But that's how it should be, trying to get to the Final Four. I love it. Now in this media stuff, I can look ahead. As you said, as a coach, you can't look ahead at all. But I know there's parts of the Razorback staff that are going to be looking at Villanova and looking at also at Baylor. And that's one of my little upset picks. I think Villanova, that winning pedigree, with two of their best players hurt and out. Gillespie is an outstanding player. And they were terrible for 2 weeks after he got hurt. But they have kind of figured it out. And they played pretty good. I think Jay Wright is an outstanding basketball coach. Not that Scott Drew's not, but I think Baylor has got I think that Villanova has got a great opportunity to knock off the Baylor Bears on Saturday. The Razorbacks may be playing Villanova to go to the Final Four.
Bold prediction there from Coach.
So.
I like it.
Yeah. And, you know, really, an Arkansas can beat either one, and you can't control it, so it doesn't matter. You know, if it was me personally, if I was coaching the Razorbacks, I'd rather play Villanova. Nothing against them. Jay Wright's an outstanding coach. That's a winning program, 2 national titles. But they've got 2 excellent players. That would be like the Razorbacks not having Moses Moody and Jalen Tate for the game.
Yep.
I mean, that's the impact that those two guys being out. But they have kind of rallied and been playing better. And Baylor's good. We'll see what will happen. I also kind of had a little feeling Wisconsin might get knocked off Baylor, and they didn't have a chance. Baylor took the fight to them. And so you're right, though. Baylor's good. And, you know, for me as a Razorback, me as an alum of the university,
I'm hoping Bill Novak's all funny. So.
It's going to be fun to figure out. One thing me and Phil want to get into, you, and I want to tie it in with the Razorbacks as well, but also with you and Chuck, the mental aspect of the bubble life that's going on right now. Now, I understand that Phil kind of brought this to my attention earlier, that you and Chuck went to the Pacers game a couple nights ago. Before we get into that, I want to real we can make this short and sweet and then get into the Pacer game. How is this team, from your vantage point, and if you were a coach on that team, how are you trying to keep this team mentally fresh right now and obviously one of the most, if not the most challenging, I don't know, 2 week, 3 week span that these guys will probably ever face, just being in the bubble life, and it's just solely focused on basketball, and we've heard the different stories that's coming out with the NCAA. How are you keeping these guys fresh if you're Coach Musselman or if you're a coach on that staff?
Well, I think that they're, you know, trying to get them out there. You know, when they get the opportunity to go to Victory Field, walk around and get them outside, they've been watching a lot of film. So they get them down there in the team room, they get them spread out, film. And, of course, they're probably getting 3, 4, 5 meals a day, so the kids are eating good. They get to load them up on the bus, go to practice, have a good workout, get a good sweat in. And, you know, the practice is probably the number one thing every day, making sure we stay sharp. Let's get a lot of shooting in. Let's get a lot of free throws in. Let's work on what we want to do on offense against ORU, you know, what we're going to do on defense. And that they're just – I think the practice is the number one key to every day, going there, exerting energy, and getting them after each other a little bit. And then the second thing is probably when they can get outside and get some air and breathe a little bit. And we've had very good weather here. They call it Chamber of Commerce weather in Indy. And today's a little rainy, but the Hogs have probably already been out there, because I've seen some teams out on Victory Field. I couldn't tell if it was Razorbacks, but this morning it was fine. It was clear. Now it's kind of rainy. But, you know, they've probably watched more film. I guarantee they've studied everything about ORU and you know, they've probably watched all the Dakotas. That's what I told somebody yesterday. You know, ORU, they play North Dakota, South Dakota, North Dakota State, South Dakota State. Coach Muss has probably had them watch every one of those 2 or 3, 4 times. And by the way, they lost all 4 of those Dakotas. And they beat them some, too. But they're also a team that lost to Kansas City. And so, you know, it's interesting. I guarantee you they'll know every plus that ORU has, and they'll know every negative that ORU has. So, the bubble life's different for those guys. I can go outside. I can walk down the street. You know, those guys don't have that. So they use the opportunities they get. I'm thinking if I was coaching them, the practice would be the number one thing every day, where they're in that arena and they can get after each other doing what they've been doing their whole lives, playing the game of basketball. Let's go hard. Whether it's 2 hours, 3 hours, whatever they can get, let's get after each other. We don't play till Saturday night. Let's get a good sweat in. Let's get better. And that's what it's all about in March, survive in advance and keep getting better.
Well, hopefully that happens on Saturday, and it happens again on Monday, and we can keep this train going, and you can stay there in Indy, and Z will be listening, doing our absolute best to sync you up with the television broadcast, because you and Chuck
are
so fun to listen
to. Yeah, do that. I appreciate it. Good, Phil, you guys have good with Mississippi State. Mississippi State this weekend, right?
That's right. I'm in Little Rock right now on my way.
Well, good luck, man. Good luck. Pulling for the Razorbacks. Have a safe trip.
All right, you too.
Appreciate
Matt
Coach
Zimmerman. Appreciate you jumping
on
with us today.
Thanks, Phil. Take care.
You got it, Matt Zimmerman. He's one of the guys you could say the one and only. There's also one and only 906 Cocktail and Cigar Lounge in Fort Smith at 906 Garrison Avenue. This is the one and only place to get the best hand-rolled cigars anywhere in the state of Arkansas. Top-shelf spirits as well. And you're not going to smell like smoke when you leave 906 Cocktail and Cigar Lounge. They have a state-of-the-art airflow system that replaces the air every 4 minutes. And they are open all weekend tonight until midnight. Friday and Saturday, they open at 4 o'clock and end the night at 1 a.m. Go to 906lounge.com to see their menu and their events. And Halftime Homework wraps it up next.